And, of course, along with that, we need to carry out a system of legal and judicial accountability. I think we should go to every single court, to the UN Security Council, to the International Criminal Court, to the International Court of Justice, to all the UN organizations that deal with this. We should go to the high contracting parties of the Fourth Geneva Convention. And we should say, if there's lack of political will to end the occupation, we need the legal and judicial and popular will to hold this occupation accountable and to expose it for what it is. Now, when people say, why are you doing that? We're saying, because if you do not give the Palestinians recourse to legal and judicial addresses and accountability, you end up only with violent resistance. We have to open all doors for nonviolent resistance in every possible way. Otherwise, if you keep saying you have to lie down and die quietly, the occupation is unaccountable. It has to remain profitable. You have to maintain a cover of impunity for Israel. It's this culture of impunity, I think, that has given Israel so much power on the ground and led to so many excesses. So these things, I believe, have to proceed. They are part of a system of the devolution of occupation, holding it accountable. Now, I'm not glossing over also our situation, which is rather painful and difficult. We do have a division, and we do have this very, very tragic rift between the West Bank and Gaza, the PLO and the Islamist movement, Fatah and Hamas, and so on. And this rift has certainly not served us well. But it is the outcome of a very abnormal and tainted situation under occupation. It is the outcome, let's say, of certain practices, abuse of power, even corruption, and people's rejection of this. But it is also the outcome of lack of progress in peacemaking and excessive Israeli violations, again, ongoing Israeli violations. The occupation has led to this type of rift, and now it is our responsibility to deal with it. And we can discuss this later, how we're going to deal with this rift. But certainly it should not be used as an excuse not to engage in decisive, rapid, urgent, concrete steps to end the occupation and to enable the Palestinians to exercise self-determination. Never use that as an excuse. Nor should it be used as a means of creating another rift among Palestinian expatriates or among solidarity movements or whatever, to take sides and to say, are you for Hamas or are you for this or how can we support? No, we are for a Palestinian cause that has not lost its integrity and its substance. We are yearning for freedom, for self-determination. These are noble causes and objectives, and we have to pursue them with full support. These are unifying themes. Let's not look for that which will divide. And we have to, as Palestinians, deal with our internal realities and heal this rift, even though we know that there are many external factors that have influenced and have brought about this rift and that have vested interests in maintaining this division. But we should do our utmost. Suffice it to say that the PLO is the address. It has been empowered, and it has been designated as the party empowered to negotiate on behalf of all the Palestinians everywhere. And therefore, it should pursue this. We shouldn't say we have no address, which was the favorite excuse of the Israelis. There is an address, and we do have a clear leadership. But I must tell you, two things are disappearing rapidly. One, the two-state solution on the ground in terms of the applicability and the ability to bring about this two-state solution because of the settlement activities and so on. And two, the continuity of a leadership that is so committed to a negotiated settlement and the two-state solution. We have a unique combination with Abu Mazen and with Salam Fayyad working together to embody peace and to bring with a political program of peace. This is not an open-ended proposition, if I may say so. It has a time limit, and what worries me is that while Israel is pussyfooting and trying to buy time and create facts and trying to create digressions and side issues and so on, and distract the Americans and go into details of whether we're going to discuss water or not, or security issues or not, and whether proximity talks that were the invention of the 1980s are going to produce results or not. Should you remember the proximity talks, Phil? Yes. They were used when one side did not recognize the other, and therefore we created this very artificial context. Actually, what Mitchell is doing is what I call, what we call, or should call, shuttle diplomacy more than proximity talk. Now, we need the international community on board. We need the international community to recognize Palestinian statehood, to help us attain sovereignty and independence. We need the Americans to have this global consensus, to head it perhaps, even if it means an international conference. We need troops on the ground also, because we believe this is one way of dislodging the occupation. And even if we reach an agreement, we have no problems having troops on the ground to ensure the security of both parties, if you will. And we need to have the will and the determination to move rapidly, to put an end to this culture of impunity and power politics, and to begin a new era in the region, because it is in everybody's interest. It's in the Arab world's interest, it is in regional, in the interest of the region, it is in the interest of Europe and the world. And of course, the standing, the credibility, and the interests of the US are all at stake. So now we have all this convergence. If there is one party that is attempting to destroy any opening for peace, it is Israel. Will it be held accountable? Will the US move rapidly in order to go, perhaps present a plan to go over the heads of the Israeli leadership and address the Israeli public and the Palestinian public by saying there's a deal to be had? Or is this opportunity going to be lost? And I tell you, this is the last minute opportunity. Otherwise, I think we are going to go to the point of no return, and it's going to be very difficult to unscramble the egg once it's scrambled. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hanan, for that very precise agenda on what needs to be done. You mentioned convening the parties to the Fourth Geneva Convention, which is overwhelmingly interpreted by the international community as proscribing, rendering illegal Israeli settlements, which are at the heart of this occupation and conflict. I believe an effort was made to do that some years ago, but the United States and others discouraged it. Would that be a viable initiative to try once again?
Yes. I think we tried it twice, Phil. And twice the High Contracting Party to the Fourth Geneva Convention that has the responsibility to ensure the applicability, to ensure compliance with the Fourth Geneva Convention. Every time they met. Now, the Americans cannot veto that meeting, but they can influence, and they did, and they politicized the Fourth Geneva Convention by saying, instead of addressing the applicability of the Fourth Geneva on the ground, the enforcement of the Fourth Geneva Convention, they discussed whether it's applicable or not. And they came up with the decision that it is applicable. Well, we know that. It is applicable. It is applicable de jure, not just de facto, as Israel says. So we got this beautiful statement that the Fourth Geneva Convention is de jure applicable to the occupied Palestinian territories. The next time was when Barak was just elected, and then we got this statement from the Americans, with the Europeans even on board, saying, well, let's give Barak a chance.